Recorded Books presents The Lost Ryu by Emi Watanabe Cohen, narrated by Kurt Kanazawa. Chapter 1. Anger and Memories. There were no big dragons in Japan, and there hadn't been for a very long time. To most kids Kohei's age, full-sized Ryu felt about as real as the cowboys in American films. Maybe they had been a part of history once, but now they were the stuff of legend. Nobody expected to run into John Wayne on their way to the market, and no one had encountered a big Ryu since bombs fell over Hiroshima and Nagasaki almost 20 years ago. Kohei was 10 years old. He shouldn't have been able to remember the big Ryu at all. He shouldn't have known how enormous they were, or how their tails could crush entire apartment buildings with a single careless swipe, or how their bodies coiled as they lumbered through the cracked streets, slow and majestic, thick tufts of fur glimmering in the wind. He definitely shouldn't have remembered the sound of their talons crunching against asphalt. But as most kids know, should has very little to do with memories. Kohei remembered the Ryu parade. It couldn't have been a dream. It was so real, so much like a memory. It had to have happened in real life. The streets were well-weathered and worn, and the skies were clear and bright, and when Kohei tilted his head back, he spotted a western dragon circling high in the clouds. It had such huge, pointy wings. Western dragons looked more like birds or bats than the serpent-like Japanese Ryu that Kohei was accustomed to. He had never seen a real Western dragon before, and he thought this one was unspeakably beautiful, in a brutal sort of way. Kohei wanted to be beautiful and brutal, and he so wanted to fly. Japanese dragons, Ryu, could technically travel through the air, but only when it was raining. They were creatures of water and mist. The ancient Ryu that lived thousands of years ago had harnessed the clouds in order to fly, shaping the air with their talons. Unless it was raining really hard, the tiny Ryu that lived in Japan now could barely even hover. In Kohei's impossible memory, the crowds of people jostling around him barely seemed to notice the circling Western dragon. They were too busy staring at the parade of Ryu marching down the street. Kohei didn't mind the jostling, for the most part, and he didn't bother looking at the people's faces. Except one. His grandfather's. Ojiisan stood near the front of the crowd, gazing at the big Ryu with an odd look in his eyes. He was younger, much younger than Kohei had ever seen him. He had dark hair and brush-thick eyebrows, and his familiar face seemed fuller than usual, even though he'd clearly been starving for months. His eyes were different, too. They were clear, shrewd, and focused. The grandfather Kohei knew was loud and bitter and numb, and he drank too much to focus on anything. And without a little Ryu on his shoulder, he was always alone. Lots of people outlived their Ryu, but most found new ones to keep them company after a while. Ojiisan never had, and now he was too tired to even try. This was the only memory Kohei had of the big Ryu, and it wasn't even a memory he was supposed to have. He had to assume that made it important. So when Ojiisan had too much to drink and started throwing things against the wall, Kohei went over that impossible memory in his mind, over and over again, studying every detail, trying to figure it out. 20 years ago, Ojiisan had tears in his eyes. Maybe tears of joy, maybe tears of sorrow. Real tears, either way. And he was looking up at the big Ryu as they marched through the street. There were no big Ryu left in Japan anymore. And Ojiisan never laughed or cried. He only yelled and drank. Therefore, Ojiisan missed the big Ryu. It was the simplest conclusion Kohei could come to. His father would have called it Occam's razor, which meant The most straightforward answer is the one that's most likely to be true. If the big Ryu came back, Ojiisan would finally be able to feel good things again. He needed them to come back. Which was unfortunate, because big Ryu were even less real than cowboys. At least John Wayne was still alive. The big Ryu were extinct and had been for nearly 20 years. Kohei shuffled into his room and flopped down across his mattress. His own little Ryu, Yuharu, clambered from the dresser to the bedpost and settled by his ear. She was small and pink, with cream-colored spines, long whiskers, and a talent for sarcasm. "Tired?" she asked. "Not really," Kohei said. "But Ojiisan is angry again." "Oh, what a surprise." Kohei ignored her. "It's because he's getting older, I think," he said. "Old people are always grumpy. You get older every day, and you've never thrown plates against the wall." "He didn't throw plates." Yuharu prodded Kohei's cheek with her talon until he looked at her. She raised one tufty, skeptical eyebrow. Kohei groaned. "He didn't," he exclaimed, shrugging her off. "It was just empty bottles. We don't need those for anything." Yuharu pulled a cherry blossom from the pouch around her neck and contemplated it, flicking it between her claws like a playing card. "You don't have to defend him, you know," she said. "I think your mother should have sent him away years ago." "She can't do that. He's her father." "He's not good for you. All you ever think about is how to make him happy." "She's supposed to respect him." "But she's supposed to take care of you." Yuharu poked Kohei's cheek again, more gently this time. "She's supposed to be your mother." "She is my mother, and Ojiisan is my grandfather. End of story." Yuharu studied his face. "Do you respect our elders?" she said. "But we don't often love them. That's why we love our humans so much, because they know how to love us back." Kohei scowled. He'd enjoyed Yuharu's profound riddle speak when he was little and still believed in mysterious things. But now that he was 10, he preferred a straight answer every once in a while. He leaned back against his pillows, gazing up at the long, thin crack in his bedroom ceiling. It reminded him of the eastern coast of Japan, curved like a crescent moon, but not nearly as smooth. Mama always said she'd patch it someday, but she'd never gotten around to it. "Yuharu?" Kohei said. "Eh?" "You're wrong about my grandfather." "Kohei-ya." Yuharu flopped onto Kohei's pillow in exasperation. "It's true. There are times when he's kind. Do you remember when I fell down the stairs last year?" Kohei rolled onto his shoulder. "Ojiisan was the one who found me. He picked me up, and he hugged me. It had been the best hug in the world, tight and real. He didn't say anything, but he was worried. He really cared." "Mm-hmm," Yuharu murmured. She wasn't convinced. She never was. Kohei plucked her from his pillow and set her back on the bedpost. "It doesn't matter," he said firmly. "Ojiisan is a good person. He just needs something to remind him how to feel happiness. Someday, I'll find a big dragon for him, and then he won't feel so alone, and he'll be happy again, and Mama will stop worrying, and we'll be a real family. Okay?" Yuharu was silent. "When I'm older," Kohei promised, "when I'm older and braver and stronger, I'll go on a quest to find a dragon, and everything will be better." "Of course," said Yuharu. "Ojiisan will be happy." "Yeah. And you'll be there to help me?" Yuharu huffed indignantly. "I'd be there if you told me you wanted to eat the moon," she said. That time, Kohei knew she meant it. Chapter 2. Last Minute Cartography. Mama's Ryu, Hana, was a practical sort of creature. She wasn't as talkative as Yuharu, but she had very sturdy teeth. Kohei shuffled into the kitchen the next morning to find her on the floor, selecting her breakfast from the neat heap of glass shards Mama had swept up the previous night. Mama was heating water for tea. She turned to smile at Kohei when she heard his footsteps. "Good morning," she said, a little too brightly. "Good morning," Kohei echoed. He settled in his usual seat. "Is Ojiisan okay?" Mama forced a smile.
"Daijoubu," she said.
That was Mama's favorite word, another way of sweeping up glass shards. Daijoubu meant it's okay, and it was almost always a lie. Kohei bit his tongue. The Ryu settled into their usual spots on the kitchen counter. Yuharu clambered up the length of the faucet and perched there, keeping a watchful eye on Kohei and his mother, while Hana piled her glass shards next to the sink. Hana didn't like high places. Her ancestors had lived with Mama's family near Osaka, which was low and humid and never very cold. But Yuharu's ancestors were Hokkaido Ryu from Papa's side of the family, so she liked snowy mountain mornings and being high up. Kohei liked those things too. It made him wonder what likes and dislikes Ojiisan had shared with his own Ryu back when he'd actually had one. Kohei kept his eyes on his breakfast, which looked less appetizing than usual. "Mama," he said, "is my grandfather going to be okay?"
"Of course," Mama said, like it was obvious. "He's always okay. He just spends too much time wishing for things he can't have, that's all."
Always okay. Did she really expect him to believe that? Kohei pressed his eyes shut until he saw red, then jabbed at his breakfast until his natto looked like rubber cement. There was a phrase that explained why Mama didn't like talking about unpleasant things. Kohei's teachers and classmates said it all the time. Shikata ga nai. It meant, there's nothing to be done. Move on, carry on, and don't brood over things that can't be helped. When Kohei was little, his father always told him to ignore anyone who said that. "You don't say shikata ga nai," he'd whisper. "You say, yame naide, yame naide. Do not quit. You must keep trying to make things better, Kohei, because there are always good things you can do." Most of the time, Kohei couldn't remember what Papa's voice sounded like. He hadn't heard it since he was 3, and 3-year-olds don't pay enough attention to silly, important things like voices. But whenever Kohei thought those words, don't quit, they were always in his father's voice. Arahata Denjiro's voice was mittens on a cold day. A lullaby, soft and slow and sure. "Yame naide, Kohei-kun. Don't quit. There are always good things you can do." But Papa wasn't here anymore, so Mama's voice was always a bit louder. "It's fine, Kohei. Daijoubu. Don't quit. It's fine. Don't quit. It's fine. Don't quit." Kohei shoveled the rest of his breakfast into his mouth and forced himself to swallow. Ojiisan slept straight through breakfast that day. Even Mama started to look a little annoyed with him. "Today of all days," Kohei heard her mutter as she tied her apron strings and headed for the door. Not that he would have been much help, but still.
"What's wrong with today?" Kohei asked.
He gathered up his dishes, then went to retrieve Yuharu from the faucet. She didn't enjoy being left out of important conversations any more than he did. Mama glanced back at him.
"It's Sunday," she said, plucking the feather duster from its spot behind the piano.
"Right," said Kohei. "Are Sundays important?" Yuharu dug her talons into his shoulder.
"Sunday," she said through gritted teeth. "It's Sunday."
"Yeah, it comes after Saturday, but before Monday. It—"
"Oh!"
Kohei jerked upright, and Yuharu had to grab his ear for balance.
"This Sunday?" Mama's lips pressed into a hard line. You need to learn to keep track of time, she reminded him.
I know, gomen.
Kohei's heart was pounding as if he'd run a mile. He had lost track of time. Ojiisan owned their whole two-story apartment building, but since their small family only needed one floor, Mama sometimes found tenants for the smaller downstairs unit. The last renters had mostly kept to themselves. They were an older couple who had cats instead of kids. But Mama had said this new family would be different somehow. What was it she wanted Kohei to do for them? Write a welcome letter? Bake a cake? It was probably something he wasn't any good at, or else he'd have done it already. Map and card, Yuharu said under her breath.
Oh, yes, right.
Kohei nearly bonked his head on the doorframe in his hurry to leave. Yuharu sighed and tightened her grip on his ear. She was accustomed to his clumsiness, but that didn't mean she liked it. Kohei might have been bad at card writing and cake baking, but he knew how to find his way around his own neighborhood at least. He grabbed some paper and a dull pencil. What would the tenants need to know? The fastest route to the overpriced market, probably, and to the slightly better market, and the place tourists went to buy souvenirs, and the place they could buy good souvenirs. He remembered Mama mentioning that the new neighbors had a child his age, so he also tried to label the best ways to walk to school. There was a long way and a short way, but it was easy to confuse the long way to the school with the medium-length way to the consulate. His welcome card was just another sheet of paper with a smiley face saying, Omedeto. Yuharu rolled her eyes and muttered something about his craftsmanship, but what else was a message like that supposed to say? The map was the most important thing. You couldn't use a welcome card to find food. Kohei presented his work to his mother, expecting her to at least be impressed with his map. But all she did was sigh, pinching the bridge of her nose.
Kohei-ya, she said.
I can make another card, Kohei reassured her. But I didn't know what else I should.
The card is fine, but I told you to write the map's labels in English, remember? I could have made a Japanese version myself.
Mama handed the papers back to him.
Just write out a second set of labels with arrows to show which word goes where.
Oh, Kohei said. He glanced warily at Yuharu. English?
You have been seeing your tutor every week, haven't you?
Yes, but
our new neighbors are moving from America. I think the mother's family was originally from Okayama, but the husband is a gaijin. Their daughter doesn't speak any Japanese at all.
Any?
Kohei exclaimed. Please be gentle with her, Kohei. Imagine how frightening it would be to move to another country without speaking the language. You would need a friend to help out, wouldn't you?
I guess so, Kohei admitted. But if it were me, I wouldn't choose me to help me. I doubt I'd be much help to myself.
You'll show her around at least?
Of course, but what if she, I don't know, what if she thinks I'm boring or something?
Yuharu smothered a giggle. Kohei was tempted to yank her tail. She hated that, which reminded him.
If I moved to a different country, I would probably just ask Yuharu to translate things, he said. She's like a mini dictionary. A lot of Ryu are.
Merci, mon ami, said Yuharu.
This American girl, will she not have a dragon of her own? Do Americans not?
The Carters have a dragon, Mama said, smoothing down a stray lock of her hair, the grayish one. But it won't be a Ryu. So it might not stay with the girl full time. American families don't, well, they don't form multi-generational partnerships with entire dragon lineages the way we do with our Ryu. They adopt their dragons like pets. And the Carters is a rare type anyway.
Mama said all of this very casually, like she was discussing plans for a pleasant outing next week, weather permitting. But only if you aren't busy, thank you very much. Meanwhile, Kohei's entire world had just ground to a halt, turned upside down, and started spinning both ways simultaneously at breakneck speed.
A Western dragon? A real one? A big one?
Kohei had heard stories of Western dragons, usually with an assortment of knights and princesses thrown in, wyverns and fire drakes and linworms, all fierce beyond his wildest dreams. They were big. They were beasts. They'd probably never make snide comments about his hair. And they could fly. That impossible memory of the Western dragons circling the sky flashed in Kohei's mind. Wide, powerful, bat-like wings, a snout with spikes instead of whiskers, the sleek, pointed nose of a predator. It surveyed the sprawl of the earth below like a falcon. Would the new neighbor's American dragon be big enough to ride? And would Ojiisan like it? Yuharu cleared her throat, tugging Kohei back into the real world. "Let's go finish that map, shall we?" she suggested. "Given the way you spelled boulevard last week, I think the translations might take a while."
Chapter 3. Not John Wayne. Kohei knew from experience that people in films were not the same as people in real life. He, for example, was neither a samurai nor a radioactive lizard monster. But part of him still half expected the new family, Sam and Reika Carter and their daughter, Isolde, to swagger down the streets of Osaka like they'd paved them themselves, glowing and grinning and calling out to strangers in a way that made friendliness seem a little bit like a threat. In movies, that's how Westerners were. They took up a lot of space, and the people around them didn't seem to mind as much as perhaps they should. But the Carter family wasn't flashy or charismatic. The father was quiet, and the mother's eyes were shrewd but kind. They said a few hesitant words in Japanese as Mama showed them around their new apartment, and Mama smiled to show them she understood. She spoke English less fluently than they spoke Japanese. Sometimes Mr. Carter switched into Russian, which seemed to come to him easier. Mama understood him better that way too, but she didn't know enough of the language to respond. Kohei heard Papa's name mentioned a few times, along with tovarish, which Kohei thought meant friend, but he couldn't follow the conversation well enough to understand anymore. Besides, the grown-ups weren't the main reason he was nervous. Their daughter, Isolde, Kohei reminded himself, seemed intent on using her mother as a human shield. Mrs. Carter kept glancing over her shoulder, trying to nudge the girl out from behind her, muttering, "Isolde, gambatte." Isolde, try. But Isolde never tried to introduce herself to Kohei, and Kohei never managed to catch more than a glimpse of his new friend. Was she scared of him? Was she hiding because she thought he was intimidating or threatening? The idea made Kohei feel prickly and guilty, half ashamed and half annoyed. He didn't want Isolde Carter to be frightened. They'd never even met before. What on earth had he ever done to her? To keep from fidgeting, he scanned the Carters' mostly empty apartment, wondering where the family would keep their Western dragon. If it was as big as the ones he'd read stories about, it wouldn't even be able to sit in the kitchen without crushing the cabinets with its spiky tail. Maybe it was just a baby right now, and when it was grown, they'd move it to a stable in the countryside like a horse. Were there special stables designed specifically for dragons? Or could horses and dragons be roommates? They seemed like the kinds of species that wouldn't get along. Wouldn't the dragon eat the horses like they did in fairy tales? Kohei wondered how long he should wait before asking all these questions. He didn't want his new neighbors to think that he only cared about them for their dragon.
こちらこそ, Mama said.
どうも, said Mrs. Carter.
いいお天気, Mama said.
そうですね, said Mrs. Carter. Why were they talking about the weather? Why were adults always so interested in nonsense? Finally, after what seemed like several decades of polite small talk, Mrs. Carter lost her patience.
Isolde,
she said, turning and dragging her daughter out into the open. She held the girl by the shoulders like she expected Isolde to make a run for it at the first opportunity.
Darling,
she said in that slow,
patient voice that grown-ups used when they were pretending they weren't frustrated. Please greet your new neighbors, the way we practiced, remember? Isolde kept her head down, so that all Kohei could see was the rough, dark waviness of her hair.
Yoshiku negai itashimasu,
she muttered.
Yes, welcome to your new home, Kohei replied politely, hoping that was the right response to whatever she'd just tried to say.
Oomph,
said Isolde. And that was that. Mrs. Carter tried to get her daughter to talk a few more times, but it was obviously a lost cause. When the grown-ups settled down among the cardboard boxes to chat about ordinary things, Isolde stayed fixed in her spot as if she'd been frozen there. She kept her eyes looking down, like if she didn't acknowledge that Kohei was in front of her, he might stop existing before they actually had to say anything to each other. Kohei wanted to walk away. Even meaningless chatter would be better than this awkward silence. But he felt weird leaving her there, so he stayed frozen like a statue, too. Would he have the courage to break the silence? Or would they stand there until the apartment building was demolished in 20 years or so?
Okay, Kohei. He steeled himself and took a deep breath. You can do this. You can be gracious and welcoming. Say something friendly in 3, 2, 1.
Is it true that there are actually 5 members of the Beatles?
He blurted out in English. It was a random, ridiculous thing to say, but at least it was ridiculous enough that Isolde had to look up in order to gape at him.
Kohei was relieved to see she actually had a face. It was a warm, expressive face, too, the kind that made it difficult for its owner to lie.
Excuse me, she said, in English.
The Beatles, Kohei repeated. The band from Great Britain, you know? John Lennon and Ringo Starr. Someone at school told me they are actually 5 of them, but 2 of them are identical and they rotate positions every few concerts just to see if anyone will notice. And if anyone does notice, then they get to become the super special 6th Beatle, king of all the Beatles.
Isolde's mouth hung half open as she tried to make sense of all that.
She began, then shook her head.
She paused.
What?
The myth of the secret beetle was a rumor an older boy at Kohei's school had started spreading at the end of last year. Kohei knew it was too absurd to be true, but it was coming in handy now. Isolde was so busy wondering what he'd just said that Kohei finally had a chance to get a proper look at her. She was taller than he was, with wavy brown hair and a pointed chin. Her eyes had long, dark lashes, like Kohei's, but they were a lighter brown than his. She looked kind of, sort of, maybe Japanese, but not completely. And even though she'd spent most of the morning hiding behind her mother, Kohei knew from the way she studied him that she wasn't actually shy. Her eyes were curious and eager, even if she was afraid. Other than that, he wasn't sure what to make of her. All he knew was that she was sizing him up too, and he hoped she didn't hate what she saw. Once Isolde was done with her inspection, she exhaled, sticking her hand out like they were businessmen, meeting for the first time. Yoroshiku onegai itashimasu, she'd said, much clearer than the first time she'd tried. Kohei grinned at her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.